Christian, let me now turn to you. Is the next pandemic tonight?
Thank you, Michel, and thank you, Thierry de Montbrial, for this invitation. 4 points. First, surveillance. Will we face new pandemics? Yes. Can we predict these pandemics? No. So surveillance is key. We are still struggling with COVID-19. That's the topic of the conversation. But at the same time, we have been witnessing monkeypox, some bursts of Marburg, and resurgence of Ebola. So the problem is not to predict. We cannot do it. The problem is early detection of the warning signals. And we have to recognize that on COVID-19, we have at least in part failed. How can we improve? A main point is to focus on the interface between humans and animals. We are all of us aware that most of these epidemics stem from contaminations of humans by animals. This is where we need to concentrate the effort, not to disperse. And this seems obvious, but this is not at all what has been done in most geographical areas. Surveillance means early detections. It also means evaluating the long-term impact of a viral infection. And I really believe, and Antoine has alluded to it, that long COVID is a potentially a major challenge. And what is new is that now we have, for the first time for a few months, longitudinal prospective studies of cohorts of a high number of individuals in a relatively homogeneous environment. And the figures show that about 30 to 50% of individuals infected by the Beta and Delta variants will show at least one symptom of COVID-19 at 6 months, and about 20%, one out of five, at 18 months. The good news is that the figures are much lower with Omicron and Omicron-related variants, and likely vaccination. We are talking about 15 to 18%. But considering the huge number of infected individuals, this is very significant. So this only emphasizes the need for these surveillance mechanisms to be tightly connected to local and regional health systems. Second, reinforcing local and regional capacities. This point has been well described by the previous speakers. I find it very striking that we have everything in hand. We have modern epidemiology, bioinformatics, biostatistics. We know how to share data, to analyze them. We can analyze wastewater samples, and which provide an accurate and very early detection of an ongoing epidemic. And at the same time, we are not sufficiently efficient. We need to base all of this on local and regional capacities, and as it has been well described, it's about human resource, equipment, overall facilities. Third, reactivity and innovation. We all know the huge success of vaccine. It's about innovation for solving a problem when a virus is detected, when a problem is identified. And we can do better for vaccines, but in particular for antivirals and diagnostics. So it's really about consortia, networks, problem solvings of academics and industrial partners with novel approach to intellectual property regulations and financial incentives. And also, I personally believe that diagnostics has been very much underappreciated in this crisis. There is a huge progress which has not been translated enough to the daily life. So again, this is about consortia and financial incentive. Also, I believe, it's obvious, we need to embrace these problems in a real comprehensive view. It's about global and One Health, merging human and animal health. But it's also about taking in consideration environment and also nutrition. Nutrition is a key factor, and in particular through microbiomes. Fourth point, novel schemes of organization. That point will be taken in the next session, but really we need much more flexible networks, consortia of individuals. Again, merging industrials and academics, problem solving, science driven, independent, also including education and training of the next generation of virologists. And the Global Virus Network is an example, but there are many others. Other networks will be created. It will be key to coordinate these efforts. This is entirely feasible with significant financial incentive, but very much worth compared to the impact of such a crisis. So to conclude, it's about surveillance. It's about local and regional capacities. It's about innovation and reactivity. It's about a comprehensive view of the problem, and it's about novel schemes of organizations and flexible networks. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Christian. And you pointed out this key issue of preparedness. One of the first lessons that we learned from COVID-19 was that the world was not prepared. And that investments in preparedness have been much, much too low over the years. And then also the way we thought we would measure the preparedness of a country actually proved to be wrong. So there is a so-called Global Preparedness Index. And that index showed that the US were among the best prepared countries in the world. But then this is one of the countries that failed totally in responding to the pandemic. So we need not only to invest strongly in preparedness now with all of these, including the science and industry and other networks that Christian mentioned, but we need to totally revise the way we monitor preparedness and our indicators.